morning, everybody. Myself, Dr. Rahul Patel. I'm assistant professor in the department of ENT, Government Medical College, Surat. So today we are going to discuss upon the rhinosinusitis, which will include what will be the definition, its classification, and we'll also talk about the acute rhinosinusitis. So what will be the learning objectives of today's lectures? So I would like all my students who are attending this class, at the end of the lecture, everybody should be able to define what is rhinosinusitis. Everybody should be able to know what is the relevant anatomy. Everybody should be able to classify the rhinosinusitis and learn how to diagnose, treat the acute rhinosinusitis. So this is something about the anatomy of the paranasal sinuses. Now on the left of your screen, you are seeing the disarticulated skull. The paranasal sinuses are the air-filled spaces within the bowl, which makes the skull lightweight, and there are many other functions. You can see here that the orange color shaded area is the frontal sinus. It is located in the frontal bone in the supraorbital region. Now this is a maxillary bone, and within the maxillary bone you can see a purple colored shaded area, that is the area where the maxillary sinus located on both the sides. And the green colored shaded area is the ethmoidal air sinuses, right? And the same thing we can see on the X-ray image. This is the radiolucent area which suggests the frontal sinus on the left side and on the right side. This is the black colored, that is a radiolucent area which indicate the maxillary sinus on the right side and maxillary sinus on the left side. And this is the area which indicate the ethmoidal sinus. Now the same thing, if you see on the live patient as a surface landmark, you can see that the green colored area, that is frontal sinus, is here in the supraorbital region in the frontal bone, and the same thing can be seen on the sagittal section here. The ethmoidal sinuses are the multiple air cell sinus which can be anterior or posterior, and it is located between the orbit and the lateral nasal wall. And if you see on the sagittal cuts, they are just on the roof of the nasal bone on the lateral wall, beneath the floor of the anterior cranial fossa, just behind the olfactory area. So this is the olfactory area, and behind the olfactory area you can see the multiple air cells. They are nothing but the anterior ethmoidal cell. And this purple color area on the both side of the nose beneath the orbit is the maxillary sinus, which is bilaterally located. Here we can see on a lateral to the lateral wall of the nose. And one more sinus which cannot be seen on the coronal cuts, we can see on the sagittal cuts, the red colored area, that is a sphenoid sinus, and on the roof of the sphenoid sinus, there is a pituitary gland. So this is again a sagittal cut. You can see the lateral wall of the nose. This is the inferior turbinate. Here is the location of the middle turbinate, and somewhere around here there will be the superior turbinate. So this is a frontal sinus which drain into the middle meatus. All these cells are the ethmoid sinuses, and this is a sphenoid sinus. Now if you see, this is a line diagram, and after cutting all the three turbinates we can see the meati. So this is the line where the middle turbinate is attached. Turbinate is also called as a nasal concha. This is the line of attachment of the superior concha. And here, somewhere around here, there will be line of attachment of the inferior concha. So this will be the orbitomeatal complex, and this is the area where from above the frontal sinus drains here. These two openings are for the openings of the middle ethmoidal air cells. And this red dot, which is a opening of the maxillary sinus. So in all, in the middle meatus, there are opening of the frontal sinus, anterior ethmoidal air cells, and the maxillary sinus. Three sinuses are opening here. If you go above the middle turbinate, that is in the superior meatus, there are opening of the posterior ethmoidal air cells. And if you still go above the superior concha, that is just anterior to the sphenoid sinus, that is known as a sphenoethmoidal recess. So in this recess, there will be opening of the sphenoidal sinus. So if we again revise the things, in the middle meatus, that is known as a orbitomeatal complex, that is complex made up of different bones, which includes the uncinate process, inferior turbinate bone lower down, and in this meatus there will be opening of the frontal sinus, anterior ethmoidal sinus and maxillary sinus. Above the middle turbinate, that is beneath the superior concha, there is a opening of the posterior ethmoidal air cells, and in the sphenoethmoidal recess there will be opening of the sphenoid sinus. So if we can summarize here, if any blockage in this area, that is the orbitomeatal complex, occipital, there will be the blockage of the frontal sinus, anterior ethmoidal air sinus and maxillary sinus. So that will create the mucosal impairment of the mucosal clearance from all the sinuses, and there is chances of the sinusitis. If there is any blockage in this area, that is in the superior meatus, then there will be collection of the mucus in the posterior ethmoidal air cells and chances of sinusitis in ethmoidal air cells. And if there is a disease in the sphenoethmoidal recess, then there will be impaired mucociliary clearance from here, and there will be isolated sphenoid sinus disease. Now let's talk about something about the respiratory epithelium. Now respiratory epithelium is also known as a ciliated columnar epithelium. You can see the different kind of cells. Most important one is this, that is a ciliated epithelium. There are multiple cilias on the surface. There will be goblet cells in between the two cells, that is ciliated cells. Now the cilia beat in a one direction, and if the cilia beats in the nasal cavity in the posterior direction, so mucus from all the sinuses drain into the respective meati, that means frontal sinus, maxillary sinus and anterior ethmoidal air cells drains into the middle meatus. The posterior ethmoidal air cells drain into the superior meatus, and the sphenoid sinus drains into the sphenoethmoidal recess. From all the sinuses they come into the respective meati, from there because of the ciliary beat, ciliary movement, they goes posteriorly towards the nasopharynx, and then they go, then the mucus goes down. Any abnormality in the respiratory epithelium, will it be because of the viral infection or because of a mechanical blockage or because of the bacterial infection, then this mucociliary clearance will be hampered, and there is a stagnation of mucus in the respective sinus which leads to the sinusitis. Now definition. There are multiple definitions given by the different bodies all over the world. The older definition, this definition is an older definition, and this definition mainly based only on the symptoms. And this is given by the Rhinosinusitis Task Force. Few years back, this was very acceptable definition all over the world, and it says that the rhinosinusitis is defined as inflammation of the lining of the nose and paranasal sinus mucosa characterized by one or more of the following symptoms. That means out of all these symptoms, there has to be at least one symptom. It will be okay if there are 2, 3, 4 or all, but at least one symptom should be there to define the disease as a rhinosinusitis. And the symptoms include nasal congestion, which is also known as a nasal blockage, rhinorrhea, sneezing, itching, hyposmia, anosmia, facial pain and headache. But the fallacy with this definition, there is no sign included in the definition. So the newer definition, which is well acceptable nowadays all over the world, that is internationally, is given by the EPOS, EPOS, that is European Position Paper on the Rhinosinusitis and Nasal Polyps. What they have done is, beside the symptoms, which we can see here in the first two row, they have included the signs, which include the endoscopic finding, plus or minus the CT scan finding, and that complete the definition. So it includes the symptom as well as the sign. So if we see, to diagnose the patient as having a rhinosinusitis, there should be primary symptom and additional symptom. Primary symptoms include nasal blockage, which is also known as a obstruction or congestion, and nasal discharge, which can be anterior or posterior. And additional symptoms include the facial pain or pressure, and second symptom is olfactory dysfunction, which may be hyposmia or anosmia. So if we want to label that patient as having a rhinosinusitis, then there are two possibilities. Either patient have one primary symptom and any one of the additional symptoms, or if patient has a two primary symptoms, then it is sufficient enough to diagnose, right? Besides the symptom, as we have already discussed, that there should be the endoscopic evidence, which may include the middle meatal obstruction or meatal obstruction simply. There may be mucopurulent discharge collected in the middle meatus, or there may be nasal polyp. Any of these three can be sufficient for the diagnosis. If endoscopic finding is there, then CT scan findings may or may not, you may or may not do the CT scan. We can see here in the bracket that CT findings, it is as well as or instead of endoscopic findings. So if we do not have an endoscopic finding, then CT scan is must. But if we have the endoscopic findings, then it is okay if we do not do the CT scan. In the CT scan finding, there can be mucosal changes within the osteometrial complex and or sinuses. So symptoms plus signs, and we have to calculate the duration. What is the duration? The duration has to be more than 10 days. If it is less than 10 days, then we cannot say that it is a rhinosinusitis. Sometimes it is just a physiological phenomenon. If the symptoms are more than 10 days and there are symptoms as well as one of the sign, then you can, and the duration is more than 10 days, then we can label it as a rhinosinusitis. If it is, the duration is less than 3 months, then it is acute, and if it is more than 3 months, then it is known as a chronic rhinosinusitis. Now classify. Again, there are many classifications, but the most acceptable classification is this one, which is again given by the Rhinosinusitis Task Force. So based on this, the rhinosinusitis is classification in the 3 different types. One is allergic, second is infectious, and third is non-allergic, non-infectious, which can simply be known as a non-allergic one. The allergy can further be classified into intermittent and persistent. In the older days, it was classified as a seasonal and perennial. Now the new terminology which is accepted is intermittent for a seasonal and persistent for perennial. The infectious rhinosinusitis is again further divided into acute rhinosinusitis, chronic rhinosinusitis, which again further divided into non-specific and chronic specific. The examples of the chronic specific are tuberculosis, leprosy, syphilis, etc. Now, the non-allergic rhinosinusitis includes many entities which include occupational rhinitis, the non-allergic rhinitis with eosinophilia syndrome, hormonal rhinosinusitis, drug-induced, the rhinitis because of the exposure to the irritants, food-induced rhinosinusitis, emotional, atrophic rhinitis, gastroesophageal reflex. And after excluding all these types of a rhinosinusitis, if the rhinosinusitis doesn't fit into any of this, then it is labeled as an idiopathic one, also known as a vasomotor rhinitis. Now, there are certain conditions in which the symptoms are almost similar to the rhinosinusitis, but it is not rhinitis, which includes the polyps. There may be mechanical factor like deviated nasal septum, hypertrophic turbinates, adenoid hypertrophy, osteometrial obstruction, foreign bodies, and choanal atresia. How to differentiate these conditions from the rhinosinusitis? Because the symptoms are almost same, like a rhinosinusitis. So here the differentiation will be possible based on the endoscopic findings and sometimes the CT scan. Sometimes the tumor, if it is benign or malignant, they can also be present with a nose block nasal discharge, which are similar to rhinosinusitis, but again the diagnosis will be made by the CT scan and the endoscopic finding, and same as for the granulomatosis and sometimes very rarely the CSF rhinorrhea. So whenever we are diagnosis or suspecting the rhinosinusitis, we have to keep all these differential diagnoses in mind. Now rhinosinusitis, especially the infectious rhinosinusitis, is classified based on the duration. So if the duration of a rhinosinusitis is 7 days to less than 4 weeks, then it is acute. If the duration of rhinosinusitis is from the 4 to 12 weeks, then it is subacute. If it is more than 12 weeks, then it is chronic. And sometimes there are recurrent episodes of the acute rhinosinusitis every year. And to label it as a recurrent acute rhinosinusitis, there should be at least 4 episodes of acute rhinosinusitis per year. If it is less than 4 episodes, that means 3 episodes, then we cannot tell it as a recurrent acute. There will be separate acute rhinosinusitis coming over the year. So again, repeating, the recurrent acute means there has to be minimum 4 episodes per year, and between the 2 episodes there has to be the asymptomatic period of at least 8 weeks between the 2 episodes. And one more entity, acute exacerbation of the chronic rhinosinusitis. That means patient is suffering from the chronic rhinosinusitis. Patient have a baseline symptom of a chronic rhinosinusitis, but over and above those symptoms, in between patient have the acute rhinosinusitis. So there will be sudden worsening of the symptoms. And once the acute episode subside, the patient will have the baseline symptom of the chronic rhinosinusitis, but patient never become asymptomatic, as is the case with the recurrent acute and acute. Now, classification of the acute rhinosinusitis. Basically, it is of a two type, viral and bacterial. So, common cold, which is very common throughout the India, is also known as acute viral rhinosinusitis, and it will last for less than 10 days. And there is an illness that is known as acute post-viral rhinosinusitis. After patient suffers the viral rhinosinusitis, it will last something around 100 days to 12 weeks in duration. Not in all, but those patients in which the virulence is higher and immunity is lower down, then they may suffer from the post-viral rhinosinusitis. ARS is considered to be bacterial if the additional symptoms or signs of the acute bacterial rhinosinusitis is present. These are the additional symptoms which will help you to label that the viral rhinosinusitis has been turned into the bacterial rhinosinusitis. At least 3 out of the 5 should be present. It includes discolored discharge. That means initially during the viral episode, the patients have a complaint of a white or a colorless discharge. And most of the time there will be unilateral predominance. But later on, after 7 to 10 days, the white color discharge has been turned into yellow or green, depending upon which organism has invaded. The second symptom is severe local pain, which was not there in the initial 7 days. And many a times it is seen that there is a unilateral predominance again. The fever, which should be more than 38 degrees Celsius, there should be elevated ESR or CRP and double sickening. What is double sickening? Patient feels that after 7 days, patient is improving. But again, improvement for a 2 days, patient the symptoms again comes up or the symptoms become severe. That is known as a double sickening. So out of these 5 symptoms and signs, any of the 3 has to be present after the episode of the viral rhinosinusitis. Then you can suspect that patient has now started having the bacterial rhinosinusitis. Now, briefly we see the classification of CRS. Now, CRS means chronic rhinosinusitis is further divided into 2 types: chronic rhinosinusitis with polyps and chronic rhinosinusitis without polyps. Now, let's see the acute bacterial rhinosinusitis. The predisposing factor for the acute rhinosinusitis include the anatomical factor, which is already there in the patient, which may include the Heller cell, concha bullosa, and the other factors include the allergy, smoking, and poor mental health. The most common viruses which are implicated in the ARS is rhinovirus, which is seen in 50% of the cases. There are many other viruses which include the influenza, parainfluenza, respiratory syncytial virus, and adeno and enteroviruses. The most common bacterial organism from last few years, because of the vaccine, the common organism has changed. Few years back, the pneumococci was the most common organism which was responsible for the ARS. From last few years, the H influenza has taken over, and now it is responsible for 44% of the cases. Now let's talk about the pathophysiology of the viral ARS. Whenever there are viruses enter into the nose, there will be cell invasion. That means the ciliated columnar cell invade the ciliated columnar cell, and there will be breach in the continuity of the epithelium. There will be damage to the cilia, the inflammatory changes, which include the mechanical changes and epithelial damage. So there will be more inflammatory cell coming into the cell, and there will be inflammation, edema, and ultimately congestion. And due to this, there will be activation of the humoral and cell mediated immunity. Now, pathophysiology of the ARS. Most of the time, the bacterial infection occurs after the viral infection. Because of the viral infection, there is already a damage on the cilia and epithelium, which facilitate the invasion of the cells by the bacteria. So there is a vicious cycle which sets in because of the bacterial infection. First, there will be sinus ostia obstruction due to the inflammation, congestion, and edema. Because of this, there will be mucus accumulation in the different sinuses. Because of the accumulation, initially there will be increased intrasinus pressure. But because of this, ultimately, immediately, there will be negative intrasinus pressure due to lack of the ventilation. And as a result, there will be impaired pH balance and impaired clearance of the inflammatory products. And the same cycle goes on again and again. And this environment in the sinuses and the nose becomes favorable for the bacteria and the bacteria flourish. So from the viral rhinosinusitis, that is the starting point of the bacterial rhinosinusitis. What will be the complications of the ARS? So complications of the ARS can be subdivided into intraorbital, which is most common, that is 60 to 75%, intracranial 50 to 20%, and osseous 5 to 10%. The common orbital complications include the preseptal cellulitis, orbital cellulitis, subperiosteal abscess, orbital abscess, and cavernous sinus thrombophlebitis. The intracranial complications include the subdural empyema, meningitis oblique encephalitis, intracerebral abscess, epidural abscess, superior sagittal sinus thrombophlebitis, and osseous, that means the complication related to the bone, include the Pott's Puffy tumor, that means subperiosteal abscess in the frontal sinus, and maxillary osteomyelitis. Now, over the years, the rate of this complication has significantly decreased, and it has been thought that it is because of the era of the antibiotics. Now, what are the investigations? As we have already talked in the definition of rhinosinusitis, the two most common investigations which are needed for the diagnosis is either nasal endoscopy or CT scan of the nose and paranasal sinus, or both of them. And what could be the findings? We have already discussed there can be edema, inflammation, mucus collection, polypoidal changes or frank polyps. The CT scan again will show the radio opacity in the sinuses or the drainage area inside the nose or in the nasopharynx. If the patient doesn't give response to the treatment, that means a usual treatment, which we'll see later on, then one may think of taking a sample for a microbiology, that means a culture and sensitivity. So microbiology is the investigation which is not required in all the patients, but only selected patients which doesn't respond to the usual medical management. The treatment. Now the treatment include the medical treatment, symptomatic treatment. So most of the cases will improve in 7 to 10 days with the help of the symptomatic treatment. That means if patient has a pain, you can give a paracetamol. If patient is complaining about the sneezing or itching around the eyes, then you can give the antihistaminics. The another entity is a decongestant, which you can give locally or systematically, systemically. But there is a problem of side effect if you give a decongestant systemically. So it is better to give local decongestant. Nasal dishing is very helpful. And you can also think of a local steroid drops. Now, what is the role of antibiotic? As we have already discussed, that it was believed earlier that a drop in the complication rate after the acute bacterial rhinosinusitis or viral rhinosinusitis is because of the antibiotic. But the current evidence shows that in those cases where the complications have occurred, even if you do not give antibiotic, or even if you give antibiotic, then those complications cannot be prevented by the prior use of oral antibiotics. So current evidence doesn't support the use of the antibiotic, at least in the initial 7 to 10 days. But of course, if after 5 to 10 days and double sickening period occurs, and if you suspect the bacterial invasion, then you can obviously think of the antibiotic. Thank you.